turn there with me, please. The Gospel of Mark and chapter 4. Kind of interested to see how this is going to go with our choir still up here. I've heard preachers my whole life say, I know I'm preaching to the choir right now. But this morning, I literally could. I could just turn around and preach to the choir for a little bit. Mark chapter 4, and you'll follow along, I hope, in verse number 1. If you need a Bible, there should be some under the chairs in front of you there. Mark chapter 4, verse 1. And he began again to teach by the seaside, and there was gathered unto him a great multitude, so that he entered into a ship and sat in the sea. And the whole multitude was by the sea on the land. And he taught them many things by parables, and said unto them in his doctrine, Hearken, behold, there went out a sower to sow. And it came to pass, as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and the fowls of the air came and devoured it up. And some fell on stony ground, where it had not much earth, and immediately it sprang up, because it had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, it was scorched, and because it had no root, it withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no fruit. And other fell on good ground, and did yield fruit that sprang up and increased, and brought forth some 30, and some 60, and some 100. And he said unto them, He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Look down in verse number 13. And he said unto them, he's talking to his disciples now, because in verse number 10 they had asked him what the parable meant. Verse 13, and he said unto them, Know ye not this parable? And how then will ye know all parables? The sower soweth the word. And these are they by the wayside where the word is sown. But when they have heard, Satan cometh immediately and taketh away the word that was sown in their hearts. And these are they likewise which are sown on stony ground, who when they have heard the word immediately receive it with gladness, and have no root in themselves, and so endure but for a time. Afterward, when affliction or persecution ariseth for the word's sake, immediately they are offended. And these are they which are sown among thorns, such as hear the word, and the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lusts of other things entering in choke the word, and it becometh unfruitful. And these are they which are sown on good ground, such as hear the word and receive it and bring forth fruit, some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100. And he said unto them, Is a candle brought to be put under a bushel or under a bed and not to be set on a candlestick? For there is nothing hid which shall not be manifest, neither was anything kept secret, but that it should come to broad. If any man have ears to hear, let him hear. We've already prayed and ask God's blessing on the message and the reading of his word. And so we won't pause again to do that. We'll continue on. In this chapter, Jesus is at the seashore. There's a great multitude of people that are gathered together to hear his words. And Jesus did not necessarily have pre-planned sermons for occasions, but it's pretty easy for the word of God to be given by the very one who is named the Word of God. So the Word can give out the Word very easily. And so they come to Jesus, and Jesus, they've got one of the smaller ships there pulled up against the shore there, and no doubt tied off or anchored in some way. And just a short ways to the shore, there's the gathering of people, and Jesus gets out there in that ship, and now he can turn and face the multitude. So you've got a kind of a natural theater sort of situation with the multitude sitting out here on the rocks of the shore, and now Jesus is on this ship, and he's going to teach them. And he starts what he's going to say to them by giving two commands. The first command is hearken, or how you and I would say today, listen. He wants them to hear what he's about to say. He's saying right here, hearken, or listen up. I have a message to give you. I have a word to say unto you. This is something that I want you to know. This is something that I want you to understand. And he follows that up by saying, behold, which is how you and I would say, look. So he starts off by saying, listen and look. Hearken, behold. Now, I've just got in my imagination, and I've told you before, I do use my imagination when I'm reading the Word, and I like to try to see these stories as details are given in the Scriptures. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with using your imagination when you're reading the Bible, so long as the details of the Bible lead your imagination, and your imagination doesn't lead the details of the Bible. But as I use my imagination, imagine Jesus getting in the front part of this ship, and he's sitting or he's standing there, and he looks over, and in the distance along the seashore, it was common knowledge that there were a lot of fields that ran right along the seashore. And I can imagine he said, listen to everybody. Everybody, if they're talking or something like that, then all of a sudden they realize he's speaking and we need to hear what he has to say. So he says, everybody listen up and give me your attention. And it's kind of like at the beginning of a service when people are standing around, they're talking, they're fellowshipping, and somebody gets up and begins to talk in the microphone. Everybody says, okay, well, I'll finish this later. And everybody goes to their seat. Okay, it's time to start. So Jesus says, listen up. But then I imagine in my mind that he points. And he says, look. And I think there might have been a good possibility that day that what he points their attention to once he gets it upon himself is there that there's a man who's out there in one of the fields that are along the sea right there. And he's got this satchel looking thing that drapes over his shoulder. And it's actually a bag. And the bag would extend up and go all the way around his shoulder. And the bag over here is full of grain. It's full of seed. And this man is going along in this field. And almost indiscriminately, he's reaching in with this right hand. And he's getting a handful of that seed. And when he comes out of there, he's just casting his hand like this. And the seed is just being distributed and it's being cast abroad. And so down near the sea where these fields would come down to, naturally there would be a rocky terrain right there that would meet the field area. And then you get up and you've got these different kind of areas. And for a moment, I just imagine in my mind that Jesus is pointing their attention by saying, look, he's pointing their attention to a man who's just doing everyday kind of labor, everyday kind of work, the kind of stuff that anybody would have seen around this area many, many times before. A man with a grain sack full of seed, and he's out there in his area, and he's walking through the field, and he's just casting it forth. He's just distributing the seed after one handful after another. As he comes out of the bag, it's already falling. He's aware of that. I mean, if the seed gets to the ground, that's where he wants it to be. That's the main goal of this type of thing. And so he's just scattering the seed. And somebody might say, well, wait a minute, some of that seed is falling on stony ground. He's aware of that. Well, wait a minute, he scattered seed all over that pathway along the field where everybody uses as a walkway. I mean, that's so trampled down. That seed's never going to get into the ground. That ground, it's dirt, but I mean, it's just trodden down hard as brick. He knows that. He's not concerned with that. He knows there's areas along the way where they don't get cultivated as much, and there's some thorns and thistles that are going to grow up there, and seed is landing in the middle of those areas. No, he's aware of that. But there's also seed that's landing on the ground that he's been out there with some tools, some pick or a hoe or whatever he's using, and he's been out there and he's been breaking up the ground and he's been raking and he's got the ground broken up. And while understandably so, that's his main target, really he's just sowing the seed. That's what he's out there doing. He's just reaching into the bag and he's just flinging it. Yeah, I tried that as a kid in a garden we were building one time. And that didn't work for my dad. We planted things in rows. You know, we read the back of the seed packet that said, this is the spacing that you're supposed to use. But I'm just telling you, you can go read it for yourself, look it up. In ancient times, they'd break up a field, and then they would go out and they would sow the seed. They didn't care if it was in rows. You say, why didn't they care if it was in rows? I mean, if it's not in rows, isn't it going to be really tough for the combine? Well, we got to think ancient here. We're not talking about a combine. They're coming through with a scythe or a sickle, and they're cutting it down like the grass of the field. They're not ultra concerned about where it goes. They're just trying to have a good crop. So what happens is they get that seed that's spread along the ground there. And I can just imagine in my mind that Jesus says, behold, a sower went forth to sow. It's almost as if he's saying, now watch him now. As he's sowing here, there's some that's fallen by the wayside. Now, Jesus is using this in a parable. So he's telling a story. There doesn't have to be a sower over there doing this, because this is a common thing that people are familiar with. And so he's not, it's obvious he's not referring to what a guy is doing right at that time. But he says, it came to pass as he sowed, some fell by the wayside. And so what happens is the seed that falls on the wayside, it doesn't fall down into the ground. The wind doesn't blow the dirt around and cover it up. It's not cultivated dirt. It's not broken up. It's hard ground. And so what happens? Well, the seed just lays right there on top of the ground, and pretty soon birds are going to come along. And if I could refer to the Sunday school message this morning, God's going to feed the birds with seed that man threw out on the hard ground. Don't get mad at the birds for eating the seed off the wayside. They're just doing what God made them to do. But that seed that sets up on top of the ground, the birds just come and they pluck that away. So what if grass grows in the walkway? Well, grass isn't going to grow in the walkway. The birds are going to eat that. Well, Jesus said, there's some seed that fell on stony ground where it had not much earth. Anybody ever been going along somewhere, maybe on a hike or maybe even in an urban setting, and you see plants growing out of concrete or out of rocks or something like that, and you realize there was enough of indention in that rock face where some kind of seed got in there, and it hardly even had any dirt, but just enough to germinate, cast up a plant, get enough photosynthesis that it started growing. And believe it or not, I've seen trees that started that in solid rock and ended up breaking the rock in pieces as that tree grew and just started with hardly any earth. Jesus says, well, some seed fell upon the stony ground and it sprang up pretty quickly. It immediately sprang up because it had no depth of earth. But he said, here's the thing about that. When the sun came up, well, it was scorched. There was not enough nutrition in the plant from the ground to sustain it. And the sun just dried it up because it had no root and it withered away. Jesus said some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no fruit. And other fell on good ground and did yield fruit that sprang up and increased and brought forth some 30 and some 60 and some 100. So here's the multitude, they're sitting there. So he tells that story, and then he says, "He that hath ears to hear, let him hear." And that seems to be the end of that discussion. So get this with me. I mean, we got to think about these things. This multitude didn't come on this day to get an agricultural lesson of things they already were perfectly aware of. Would y'all agree with me on that? This multitude didn't leave their homes, maybe even some of their businesses and things like that, to go out to this man that everybody was talking about and find where he is and congregate together and sit down on a seaside and him get in a boat and just point out the telling of an agricultural story that everybody has seen play out in their lives. That's not why they came. Watch this. Jesus understood why people needed to listen to him, and he had a desire to speak to the people who came to him for the right reason. Are y'all with me on that? If you want an agricultural lesson, you probably would be better off not coming out to Jesus that morning. You say, what, Jesus doesn't know about agriculture? Oh no, he knows about agriculture. Because he made agriculture. He made all the plants. He did that during the 6 days of creation. He knows about agriculture. But I'm saying, Jesus wasn't getting up there saying, now look, everybody look over here. Okay, there's a man sowing seed. Now let me tell you a story. There was a sower that went out to sow, and he was just throwing the seed around, and some of it fell here, some fell here, some fell here, and some fell here, and the seed had different responses because of the ground it fell on. Now, let's pray and go home. What happened to the seed is not the point of the message. The point of the message is that there are people in that congregation that have come that day to get something deeper than agriculture. They've come to him because this man speaks words that no one else speaks. This man does things that no one else does. This man changes lives like no one else changes lives. But here's the thing. If you want your life changed by Jesus, then you have to want Jesus to change your life. I know that sounds very rudimentary, but I do believe there's some depth to that statement. Can I say it again? If you want Jesus to change your life, then you have to be willing for Jesus to change your life. Because there are some people that are interested in Jesus as a person, and they're interested in Christianity as a religion, and they're interested in the theological concepts, and they're interested in the philosophical concepts of Christian religion, and they might be interested in this and interested in that, and maybe even they want things in their life to change, but they're not real interested in Jesus changing their life. So watch this. If you just wanted something from Jesus, and you came and you listened to what Jesus had to say, and that's what he said, there's a good chance you're going back home going, oh, I didn't get anything out of that. Went out there this morning. People said this guy changes lives. I went out there this morning. He talked about sowing seed. He talked about it landing on ground. It grows up in different ways. Some of the plants make it. Some of the plants don't make it. Some of them never get to be plants. And some of them produce fruit. But I know how to grow vegetables. But imagine with me this. Somebody goes out to the seashore that day, and they have faced something in their life just recently that has challenged the way they think about life. And now all of a sudden, the burdens of life weigh so heavy on their heart that they're thinking, if this man can change my life, then I'm willing to listen to anything he has to say. And when they show up to hear the words of Jesus, they're listening for what Jesus has to say to them about what they need in their life. So they're not hearing about ground and seeds. Watch this. They're looking for a deeper and more personal meeting to what Jesus has to offer. Can I tell you, this is the exact same thing that Jesus did in John chapter 5 and John chapter 6. In John chapter 5, Jesus taught a group of 5,000 men plus women and children. And his disciples said, you know, it's getting late, send them home. They need something to eat. Jesus said, you give them something to eat. They said, well, we don't have enough money to buy food for all of these people. Well, do you have any food here? We got one little boy. He's got 5 loaves and 2 small fishes. What is that among so many? Jesus said, bring it here. Jesus blessed it, broke it, gave it to his disciples. They started passing it out to the people. Next thing you know, 5,000 men plus women and children have all eaten from 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And by the way, it wasn't like they just all had a little snack to hold them over. The Bible says they ate till they were full, and then the disciples collected 12 baskets of leftovers. And it was good food. Some of you are looking at me right now like, preacher, how can you possibly know it was good food? Because I'll tell you how you can know if a place offers good food. If you go back. Come on, am I telling you the truth? If you go someplace and the food's not good, you're probably not going back. But if you go someplace and it is just really good, the next day you're thinking, you know what, I could run that back again. I'm not going to, but sometime soon I'm getting back over there and I'm eating that again. You know how I knew it was good food? Because that entire multitude the next day, they went looking for him again. When I say went looking for him, listen to me now. When I say they went looking for him, they went to the other side of a lake to find him. And when they couldn't, they went back to the other side of the lake, still looking for him. And when they found him, they're like, where were you? We were looking for you. We wanted to spend more time with you. And Jesus just draws right to the point. He says, yeah, you were looking for me all right, but you weren't looking for me because of anything I said in my teaching yesterday. You were looking for me because yesterday you got your belly full and you came back today to get another belly full. And what Jesus proceeded to give them in John 6 was not a belly full, but an earful. And he taught them again, but in a much more direct way, so that when he was done talking, they said, these are hard sayings. And they went away and didn't follow him anymore. And he turned to his disciples and he says, will ye also go away? And they said, where will we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. You see, there were some men who followed Jesus because of the legitimate change he made in their life, while there was others who were just interested in Jesus for changing the things that they wanted change, like physical hunger to physical satisfaction. But Jesus said, that's not why I've come. I've come to bring more fundamental change to people's life than just satisfying their bellies. You can eat good food almost anywhere. And I'm glad you enjoyed the meal yesterday. I mean, after all, he did that out of compassion for them. But the next day, he made it abundantly clear. This is not my ministry. I'm not a food bank I'm not a soup kitchen. I've come to change people's life at a fundamental level. I've come to bring change into people's life that is lasting change, that changes them so profoundly that they literally become a new creation in Christ Jesus. That's why I've come. I've come to make people new. I've come to see people rid of their sins. I've come so that people's life actually becomes fruitful in the way it is lived. But to do that, that requires fundamental change. And the only thing that can do that, watch this now, the only thing that can do that is the Word of God affecting our lives. So he says, a sower went forth to sow, and he cast this seed out there. Now, there's a lot of people that say, well, that seed represents the gospel, and it goes out, and you know, some people you share the gospel with, their heart is hard, and they don't receive the gospel, and so they don't get saved. And then there's some people that they receive the gospel, and they get saved, but it's stony ground, and so that means their heart is hard, and so the sun comes up and it scorches it, and their plant withers and dies. I'm trying to figure out how that relates to salvation, but anyway, then there's other seed, the gospel that goes into the thorny ground, and people get saved, but that gospel gets choked out by the thorns and thistles. But hang on just a second. Jesus didn't say that the seed was the gospel. He said it's the Word. And let me just tell you that there are some applications here to the gospel, but I believe what Jesus is talking about here is more than just a person receiving the gospel. I believe what he's talking about is whether or not a person is really to follow Jesus Christ. Meaning become a disciple of His Word. And follow His Word as the Word of truth. Because after all, the goal of what's trying to be accomplished in this parable here is not just salvation, but fruitful living. Isn't that it? That's the goal of this, is that there's lives that produce fruit from the Word of God having its effect in them. Certainly, this is not possible without receiving the gospel. Let me just tell you something. Your life can never be spiritually fruitful without Jesus Christ. It's not a possibility. Without a relationship with God, you can't have spiritual fruit in your life. And by the way, you want spiritual fruit in your life. Galatians tells us what fruit of the Spirit actually looks like. It's love, joy, peace, temperance, long-suffering, patience, goodness, gentleness, faith, meekness. It's all of those things. And we get that by having an actual relationship, walking with the true and living God. And I got news for you. You can't have that relationship if you don't know Jesus Christ died for your sins, rose again to be your Savior, and by faith call upon Him and ask Him to forgive you and save you. Without being saved, you cannot know the fruit of God that He wants your life to produce. Just can't know that. And that does involve hearing the word of the gospel, believing that you are a sinner who have personally done things that are offensive to God, that you need God's forgiveness for, and by faith trusting that when Jesus came and lived a perfect sinless life and died on an old rugged cross, He wasn't dying because He was a sinner, but He was dying for your sin and for mine. And He rose again from the grave, proving that He was more powerful than sin, more powerful than death. And I'm so thankful that October 17th, 1984, I got on my knees, and in childlike faith, I asked Jesus to forgive me of my sin. And I believe that His death on that cross and His resurrection was for me. And you know what God did for me that night? He forgave me of my sin. He made me a new creation in Christ Jesus. But watch this. Even though I receive the free gift of eternal life that comes through faith in Christ for salvation, that doesn't mean any spiritual fruit was produced in my life yet. Hang with me here. There can be people who get saved, but struggle their entire life to actually have peace. There can be people who get saved and have the hardest time ever finding joy. There can be people who get saved. I'm talking about put their faith in Christ. Just acknowledge their sin. Put their faith in Christ. People who get saved and struggle with sin for the rest of their earthly lives. Struggle with living in this world. Struggle with temptations. That is not why we are made a new creation in Christ Jesus. But it happens when someone receives the gospel, but then chooses not to receive Jesus' other words. I mean, we know this morning, don't we? The gospel is not the only thing Jesus said. Jesus had other things that he said. Jesus gave other commandments. Jesus taught us other ways in which we should live. Look, this will prove it to you. Matthew chapter 28, Jesus told his disciples, "Go ye and teach all nations." Do you know what he's talking about, teaching all nations? Well, in particular, the gospel. Go ye and teach all nations the gospel. And people who trust in the gospel, baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. And then he goes on, because he's not done yet. He goes on to say, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. You know what that means? There's more to learn after the gospel. There's more to be taught after the gospel. There's more to Christianity than a crucified Lord and a risen Savior. Is everybody with me here? And it is found in His Word. We have four books called the Gospels that teach us more than the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, but teach us everything that Christ commanded us. And then after that, in the New Testament, we have the writings of one disciple, an apostle, after another, that teach us how to observe all things whatsoever Christ commanded us. Why? Because following Him and living according to His Word and building our life upon what Jesus said yields a life that is lived enjoying the fruit of what God created us to be. So guess what? The sower sowing the word is more than just the evangelist communicating the gospel. It's also the Sunday school teacher teaching the Sunday school lesson. It's also the mom and dad in family devotions. It's also the pastor who's preaching the word. I mean, we can't just look at this parable this morning and say, "Yeah, well, I'll tell you what, preacher, I'm glad that somebody sowed the word in my life and I trusted Jesus as my Savior." That is wonderful. That's the greatest decision anybody could ever make. And if you're here this morning and you've never made the decision to agree with God that you're a sinner and trust in Christ's death, burial, and resurrection for your salvation, would you please make that decision today? Would you please call upon Christ for salvation today? But if you want to see the fruit of being what God created you to be in your life, then you need to know God's word and do it. You need to listen when the seed of God's word is being sown in messages, in Sunday school, in your daily Bible reading, in family devotions, in your personal time. You need to be soaking in the word of God and being good ground in which that word can grow and develop. Because I'll tell you this, there are saved people who are as hard as the wayside. And the word gets sown, and they say, well, I'm glad that was preached. Somebody's going to benefit from that. I don't need that. But I'm sure somebody needed that. And here's what happens. It's not going to matter much to them, because pretty soon Satan's going to come along and pluck that seed before it can ever play a role in producing spiritual fruit in their life. Because their heart's hard. And there's saved people whose hearts are stony ground. Well, what's that look like? Well, here's how I relate to stony ground. The stony ground are people who want a quick fix. Instant gratification. Well, I got news for you. Any vegetables or fruit you've eaten of late did not instantly spring out of the ground and appear on your plate. There was a process of growth and development it had to go through. And if you want to see fruit, actual spiritual fruit in your life that God meant for your life to create, it's going to be a process. It's going to be a process of obedience. It's going to be a process of faithfulness. It's going to be a process of resisting temptation. It's going to be a process. I'm just telling you, the Christian life is not about instant gratification. But there are people that look to Christianity for instant gratification. Maybe it's a guilty conscience, and somebody says, I don't want this guilty conscience, so I'm going to run into Christianity real quick. I'm going to get me a little salve for my guilty conscience, and then I'm going to go forward. Well, let me tell you something. You might get a little guilt relief for a short period of time, but you're not going to see any lasting fruit in your spiritual life. And I'm just going to tell you, as a pastor, I've seen it. Some married man leaves his phone unlocked on the coffee table, runs to do something. While he's gone, his wife picks it up, searches through it, finds all kinds of trash and filth on his phone, and confronts him with it when he gets back. Watch this. He gets mad at her for going through his private stuff. God help you, man, to get mad at your wife for confronting you with your trash and your filth, and to try to get mad at her like it's her fault, like it's her problem. Well, that sits on him for a little while, and he realizes he is wrong, and he feels kind of guilty about that. And moreover, she's mad. And she should be. No, there might be some men right now going, Pastor, don't say that. She was just about to forgive me. Don't tell her she should be mad. No, I'm telling you, that's one of those be angry and sin not situations right there. She's got a right to claim your singular focus and you not be casting your eyes all about. And so, man, things are kind of rough at home. And so I'll tell you what, I'll just go to God and I'll fix this real quick. Let me just tell you something. It's not this acknowledgement. It's not that the man says, wait a minute, I have a problem with sin because God's word hasn't been in my life like it should be. And what I need is God's word in me, cleansing my iniquity, washing me from the inside out, changing my life. I need God's word to change my thinking, change my heart, change my perspective. I need an overall here. An overhaul is what I mean to say. Not an overall like the denim things, but I need an overhaul here accomplished by God's word having its effect in my life. No, it's not like that. It's like, I tell you what, I'm going to run in, ask God to forgive me. Then I'll come out, I'll tell her, hey, I ask God to forgive me. Would you please forgive me? And now everything will be better and we'll go on. I just got news for you, because I've seen this too many times. It's not better. You know why it's not better? Because nothing's changed. You wanted God to put a Band-Aid on something real quick, but you didn't want to give place for His Word to germinate in your heart and grow up into something that actually produces fruit. So we listen in a message and we get convicted about sin. And maybe in our seat, or maybe if it's really bad, we go to the altar. We say, God, forgive me. But are we spending more time in God's word to replace what we just asked God to take out? You understand what I mean by if we really want God to change lives, we're going to have to be willing for him to change our life. That means changing everything about us. And sometimes we can just want the quick fix. And so we get the quick fix, and all of a sudden, the quick fix feels good. Man, I asked for God's forgiveness, and he promised he would always forgive. And I asked my wife's forgiveness, and she says she's forgiven me. I mean, it's still kind of rough, but we're getting through it, and it's better. And I'm just telling you, that's there for a time, but then the sun comes out, and because there's no depth in that experience, then what you think you accomplished just dries up. And you realize you're still where you started and nothing's changed. And the next time you think you can get away with it, you'll do it again. Everybody with me on this? Sometimes the seed falls on thorny ground. And it falls there and the plant grows up. But the problem is nobody's weeded that thing. nobody's cultivating it. Nobody's looking after it. So the thorns just kind of grow around it and choke it. And it can't produce fruit because the weeds around it are taking all the nutrients. And then the thorny plant itself is just wrapping itself around the good plant, and there's no chance anything of value can grow on that. And people are like, well, I got a plant. Well, I know, but your plant is so consumed by the things of this world, you have no lasting spiritual fruit in your life. What's that look like? Well, Jesus said exactly what it looks like. The cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches come in. And all of a sudden, your life becomes more about you fulfilling the desires of your flesh than denying yourself and following Christ and being a disciple of his. And you're so busy pursuing riches and what he called in the Sermon on the Mount, mammon, and all of these different pursuits and passions. You're so busy doing you that there's no possibility that there's any spiritual fruit being accomplished in your life. Because the word is not affecting your life. The world is affecting your life. Isn't it amazing? There's only one letter difference between word and world, but how big of a difference they are in how they influence our lives. And we get so wrapped up in the things of the world. Paul reminded us in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, the things that we can see are temporary and they're all going to pass away. But Jesus said we ought to live our life to lay up treasures in heaven, where moth nor rust doth not corrupt, where thieves do not break through and steal. Things that really matter. But that involves taking care of the thorns and the thistles and making sure that the word has true effect in our lives. Praise God for those whose hearts and lives are good ground. And they are those who hear the word of God, and the plant grows up and it produces fruit. Some 30, some 60, some 100. But the point is this: there's fruit. There's something important there. There's something valuable there. There's something lasting there. Listen, I don't know where you're at in your spiritual life this morning, but I just want to communicate this. I know where God wants you to be. I know God wants to fill your life with a peace that passes all understanding. I know that God wants to fill your life with a joy unspeakable and full of glory. I know that God wants your life to be rooted and grounded in something that can never, ever, ever change. God wants to impart strength to your life that is stronger than the worst storm you're ever going to face in this earthly life. And I want to challenge you and encourage you this morning. That can only be found when you say, God, I want your word to have its full effect in my life. I want my life to be based upon it. I want my heart to be yielded to it. I want my mind to be conformed to it. God, I want your word to transform my life. And if you come to Jesus for anything else, you're not going to find what you're looking for. But if you want him to change your life, he's still changing lives today. He's still producing fruitful lives today, and he does it through his word. We're going to have a time of invitation. It's just simply this, a time for people to respond however God might have spoken to your heart. You say, well, preacher, how am I supposed to respond? Honestly, that's up to you and nobody else. Nobody's going to come to you this morning and say, hey, you need to be doing this or you need to be doing this. How you respond is up to you. But can I ask you a couple questions this morning in regards to that? If you know this morning that you've sinned, that you know you've done things, thought things, said things that were against God, and you need his forgiveness for that, if you want to be forgiven of all your sin, Jesus died for you. And he paid that penalty. And if you want to know this morning how you can come and call upon him and ask him to be your Savior, and he'll forgive you and save you and give you the free gift of eternal life, then in just a moment, when we stand and sing, there's going to be an opportunity for you to step out from where you're sitting right now. And if you'll come to the front here, myself or one of our other men or ladies will meet you here at the front, and we will be happy to take God's word. Look, we don't want you leaving here today with faith in what we've told you, but we'll show you from God's word where he says you can be forgiven, where he says you can be saved for eternity. And we'll be happy to show you that in his word. And you can call upon him and know that your sin's forgiven and that you have everlasting life. If you are a child of God this morning, you know that your faith is in Christ, but your heart hasn't been the ground that it needs to be. May I encourage you to step out and come to this altar and say, God, break my heart. Soften my hardened ground. God, I don't want to be that wayside ground where Satan just comes along and steals my opportunity for a fruitful life. God, I don't want to be the stony ground that just gets joy out of the immediate decisions, but I never see anything lasting in my life. God, I don't want to be that thorny ground that's choked out by things that don't matter. God, I want to be that good ground. And God will help you. God will help you. Heavenly Father, I pray that you'd bless this time of